Okay, you have to remind me if I forget sometimes to start to record. We have been recording all our classes so that students who for some reason are not able to join the class at that point of time, they can have access to it at a later stage. Or if you want to revisit the class, you can also come back to that class. If I forget to start recording, I'll as usually remember, but I come back to a class after a gap of a month or so, so I forgot that we record. So now tell me, can you identify what makes you a man or a woman or the other? Individually, I'm not saying generally speaking. Apart from your biological body, why do you identify yourself as a male, female, or the other? If there is any other that they can identify, because already open others. We do have some students in the faculty which are open other. Anybody who think they are a woman in this group? Okay. So tell me, Devinder, why do you think you are a woman? Did you get my question correct? I'm not asking you whether you think there are women in the group. I'm saying there are people who think they are women. Is class mein koi woman hai? Is there any woman in this class? So we got one hand up. Two, three. So tell me, what is it that makes you a woman?
Ma'am, may I speak?
Yes, yeah.
Yes. Apart from the initial socialization into thinking of yourself as a woman, how your parents call you a daughter, etc., I think for women it's specifically more pronounced because of the kind of violence they face in an everyday scenario. How this becomes, because of this, they become a united gender, I would say.
No, Ria, I'm asking you individually for each one of us. What makes you think you are a woman? Or let's put it slightly more vividly, how do you think you are different from men? Or how are the men different from you? So men can think about how are the women different from them, and women can think about how are the men different from them. Rather, you can speak about yourself, or you can talk about the other. If you think you are a man, then how are the women and the other are different from you? If you are a woman, you can also think as well. How men and other are different from you, or what distinguishes you from the others? Yes, Yashvi.
May I speak, ma'am?
Yes.
Apart from, all the gender discrimination that we women had to go through all our lives, or the other women that I know, that actually, that's when you see it, us nazar se, then it is bad. But when I see it, yes, it has made me more sensitive. I am more empathetic, and I know how to cook. I know I can run several errands at the same time, but that does not mean that I'm a woman and I should do it. Thanks to my education, thanks to so technology intervention, that I know what an ideal woman, or what, for take you, for example, okay, you you're a woman in totality, and you're an inspiration for many of us. Okay, and thanks to all of these, that yes, the gender discrimination plus the education have played a role in making me an individual, a human being first, as well as understanding that yes, men at the same time lack the values that the women were taught at an early age, and men were not. So I have turned out to be like this, like I am today, and men at the same time my age have not. That man.
So you think you are better human being than men?
I am more sensitive. I am more empathetic. I am, I will understand things better than most of them. I'm not saying that, you know, it is because that they are men and I am a woman because, but it was because of the values that were instilled in me at a very early age, that because of them I became what I am today. And thanks to education, of course. No doubt.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, so no, let's analyze all these statements. So one thing is that there is a kind of a denial being a woman, I'm not very sure whether I've understood very clearly what you've said. But what I'm hearing is partly that some part of you feel that you are a better human being because you have got empathy. And this better human being can be vis-a-vis other women. It can be vis-a-vis other men. It can be vis-a-vis all other human beings.
Exactly.
You are among the group of people who are more empathetic, who are more caring, who have got more skills, more multitasking.
Hmm. Exactly.
So in that statement, mm-hmm. it's not a pride coming, I have all these skills because I'm a woman.
No, ma'am, exactly not. But it was because
right.
of...
So yes, in ma'am. That statement, we are denying our womanhood.
Okay.
It is not important to be a man or a woman. It is important to be having certain qualities.
Yes, ma'am.
And the qualities you think which are better qualities for a human being are that of compassion, caring, multitasking. Okay. Now let's look at the counter view, because the counter may come from the, you know, how we traditionally construct men or manhood and masculinity is power, vigor, aggression, not aggression necessarily negative, but courage,
yes,
protection
ma'am.
For the others. All these are the other values with which men are brought up.
Right.
So are we saying being courageous is a less important value than being empathetic and caring?
Ma'am, I just recently debated this.
Powerful is less important than caring, because this is where the contrasting values comes in, Yashvi.
Right. But yes, ma'am.
What has been done in our understanding and our upbringing is that we have divided values. These are masculine values. These are feminine values. Women should be shy. They should be beautiful. They should be caring. They should be loving and affectionate. All these are seen as feminine values and good for them, but not necessarily good for the men. What should the men be doing? Men should be courageous. They should protect. They are clear-headed. Women are all confused. No, we have created all these categories. So, whether being confused, for example, is it a human trait or is it a woman trait? Whether being courageous is a human trait or it's a male trait? And the way we have set up our society, we have said that whatever we have said are the male traits are more important. And that is why women like to be like men. Why not Dangal film? मारी छोरी छोरों से कम थोड़ी है. So women are aspiring to be like men because what men present to us is seen as a higher value. I may claim that no, I'm more caring and therefore I'm better. But when you look at society around us, women are aspiring to be like men. They should be as independent as men. They should be as courageous. They should join the army like men. No, they want to do everything which men have been doing. But are the men wanting to do everything which women have been doing? Which is physically possible, but not in childbirth. That's not physical possibility. But all other things are physical possibility. But we had this film, Ki and Ka. So this hero in that film wants to be like the mother, the housemaker. how much turmoil there is in that relationship, even though initially they're very happy. But to accept that my husband is a housemaker wasn't an easy job for the woman in the film. When it came to the one-to-one relationship, it was fine. But publicly, she wasn't open to that idea reflected in the film as such. I like that film very much. I mean, if you have seen Ki and Ka, the film Ki and Ka?
Yes, ma'am.
If those of you have not seen it, I suggest during the course of this course, you must see that. So somewhere, what I was trying to identify in Yashvi's narration was that to say that we always give values a certain value, a certain traits a certain value. So women would want to say caring and love and affection is a lot more important value than being courageous and being brave. It is, the crying, for example, is seen as a trait which women have. Not that the men don't have a tears duct, they also have this. But they are brought up to control that. So whether controlling the tears is a good thing or crying is a good thing, it's a value judgment. There's nothing natural about crying or not crying. Both of them are something which if you let go of yourself, you can cry. If you hold on to yourself and you kind of tighten yourself, which is not necessarily a good thing in long term, because unless you have a catharsis and you can take your emotions out, you can burst. It does happen in both cases, both for men and women. And we'll see this in the course also. So somewhere we want us to reflect that whatever we think of ourselves, that certainly we all believe that we are the best human being. Each one of us believe that. And I take it for granted that each one of us have a reason to believe that I am a good human being. I'm better than the other in certain respect, at least. I may not be better than another person from all respect, but in certain respect, I'm certainly better than the other. We were okay with that. We got no issues with that. But to recognize that if I have this value, this is something good in me, there is something good in the other as well. Recognizing the good in the other can only lead to equality conversations. But if you say that whatever I have is the good, whatever I have is the better thing, and whatever the others have is only good, then there is a hierarchy. And this course is all about challenging the hierarchical thinking. We constantly create hierarchies. In the given hierarchy, we have a paternalistic hierarchy, where the patriarchal hierarchy, where men have got a higher position than women have. And the third one is even lower than the women in our social setup. So these hierarchies are the basis for discrimination. And unless we understand that there need not be hierarchies. Crying is as important as not crying, depending on the circumstances. Being courageous, being powerful physically is a contextual category. There's nothing absolutely. If saying a powerful being physically is more strong is the most important quality to determine whether somebody is superior or not, then who should be the most superior being, not only human being, or human being also? Then all these hulks, all these, what do you call them? The wrestlers, the boxers, the physically strong men among the men, they should be seen as superior. But do we recognize that? We do not think physical power is the only thing. Physical power, the power is counted in horsepower. The horse is a very powerful being. So, but do we consider horse to be a better being than a man because the man has got lesser power? Similarly, we cannot say women are not good because they do not have as much power, as physical power as men have. So the first lesson we should take for ourselves, and as we start thinking about this for today's class, would be to think of hierarchies in understanding traits. Something in my bringing up has made me a man or a woman, the way I was brought up. And most of the time, our parents tells us, you might have, some of you might have seen it. if you were a boy and you entered the school and was beaten up by your class fellows who came back, your parents would say, लड़का होके पिट के कैसे आ गया, दो हाथ लगा के आने थे ना. If a girl came back crying because the class fellows had beaten her up, you think, मैं कल स्कूल चलता हूँ, I'll ask your teacher, how can students beat you up? The girl was not there, तू भी मार के आती. So this is how we said girls should fend and should, there will be a protector for them and they are subjected to violence. Men can take their own recourse on their own, they don't need another person to do that. Has anyone had this experience in your childhood when your father or mother went to the school because you were beaten up by your class fellow, or whether they asked you to settle your own scores? Okay, we'll continue this conversation in our next class. Next class is on Monday. Do you have the timetable? Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
You have the timetable?
Yes, ma'am.
So our class on Monday is from 3:50, I think. Is that correct? Okay, check your class. I'll send you the invite for the class. And everybody, before you leave today, please mark your attendance by writing P in the chat box. Can you write P in the chat box?
Yes, ma'am.
You don't want to mark your attendance? What happened? Why are you not marking your attendance? Oh, okay, no, because this is not moving. I thought it will move. Okay, yes, I can see. Oh, there are a lot more other chats which I didn't see. Since birth. Okay, I'll read this only because of my body, not because of any other aspect. Quality of being over possessiveness. Has set up to certain traits and threshold to be called a man or a woman. You know, Shahbaz and anybody else, I'm not asking, when I was asking this question, I was asking us to think individually. Because all of us, if we know ourselves, only then we can understand what's happening around us. So I would want you to think of yourself as to what has made you, what is your characteristic. What is your strong point because of which you think you are really the man? You know, real man hai ki, real woman hai. And of course, most of us are neither a real full woman or a full man. We will certainly have certain qualities which ordinarily belong, or somebody claim that they belong to the other. And that's perfectly all right. But is there something typically? Yashvi said that I am a woman, and a lot of women get, I don't know, she used some adjective also before a woman. It says, I am an inspiration. So what is it in my personality which makes me a woman which gives inspiration? Whether it would have, the inspiration would have been different if I wasn't a woman. So the question you have to ask yourself. So One way of thinking is, of course, because despite being a woman, you are able to do this. No? That's one way to look at another woman. Who? So what is it that inspires you? Because I'm a woman. And whether the same thing would have still inspired you if I wasn't a woman. I want to thank Keshvi and anybody else who thinks on those lines. Because some of you have come back to my class because you want to go through one more session with me, or you want to attend one of my sessions because I've heard certain things about me. I want you to identify what is it for yourself which makes you the man or the woman. So certainly some of the things I can see here is that you have been told you are a woman and therefore you are. You have been socialized like how the women or men should be. What are those traits or what are those aspects of socialization which you have been encouraged to adopt as a woman or as a man? You can make a personal list, and if you want to share them, You can do that in our next class. I would encourage you, I'll write down the reference to a reading. You can glance through it. Have you heard about National Family Health Survey, number 5? When you do a search, you will be able to find it. So, but I want you to
also, ma'am, are there any prescribed readings for this course or any books?
It is a prescribed reading, but last year reading says number 4, but now we have got a new edition, number 5. So let me just write it here. National Family Health Survey, number 5. This, I think, is 2019 and 2020. This will, you can download this, a PDF file available, the key findings. You don't have to necessarily read through the whole thing. Try to browse through where the data is about education of men and women, mortality rate of men and women, access to health, where you find the parameters of what constitute a status. What are their views about violence? How much violence women and men face in their lives? So those kind of data is there. I want you to have a look at that over the weekend and come up with some interesting figures which you think are interesting from your perspective, which you can, you don't have to know. So I would encourage you to look at that. And if somebody, not for Monday, but some stage, if you would want to make a presentation on that data, it will be very good. Anybody can volunteer to make a PPT and present the data relating to it. It's a kind of an update. The traditional, the first report on status of women was in 1974. So that's the first status of women report, which actually gave impetus to the discussion and focus when I forget now who said that you wanted to know the history to some extent, and to some to some extent you will get that history in Status of Women report, which is the starting point of conversation of status of women in India. Then we had a revision, an updated version in 2001, I think, by Sarla Gopalan, who presented the data as to what has happened from 74 to 2001. Now we are having this survey coming periodically. So this survey also tells us what is the status today. How many women get married at a certain age? How many men get married? What are the implications of that? How many childbirths? What is the mortality rate? What are the health parameters? So all that is there because we need to be familiar with the factual situation, rather than what the newspapers tend us to believe and what our neighbors and whatever, sometimes our lived experiences are, or also that way. So my lived experience may be very different from what the national data is about. So I want you to become familiar. You don't have to remember the exact figures, but you should be aware of what are the trends in which fields women are doing better numerically compared to men and vice versa. And this survey, I have yet to check myself also whether this has got any figures, facts available for LGBT, the other set of human beings. We were not even recognizing that they existed until NALSA said, no, there is a legal recognition. They were there, but in law, they didn't exist. They don't exist for most purposes even now. So we'll have to check that out also, whether National Family Health Survey talks about only men and women, or does it talk about the other also in the families? So, okay, we'll meet on Monday.
Thank you, ma'am.
You're welcome.
Thank you.